I have written my autobiography.
Oh, you did?
Well, it's not finished because I'm still alive, but...
Well, the biographies can be written, and you
read. I probably should update it, because it's only 2 years since I looked at it. It's about 19,000 words at the moment.
It is about what?
19,000 words.
Words. Okay, yeah. I thought pages.
Well, pages...
That would be...
Pages... about 300 pages. 16, 70 pages. Something like that. Yeah.
Must be quite interesting, so maybe well, you'll tell
lot,
us.
I've been to a lot of places. So.
Yes.
I've lived a long time.
The longer we are here, the more stories we have to tell, don't we?
Yes. The problem is you don't want to repeat yourself. Have I told you this already?
Yes, of course.
Especially where my wife is concerned.
Yes, my daughter says...
Every time you come here, you tell me exactly the same thing.
Yes. My daughter tells me, right, when I start the sentence. You told me that before. Sorry.
Yeah.
She'll come to the day, Joyce.
Well, I hope so.
Yes. She stays healthy as you will.
Yeah, do you want glasses on the bottom?
It's okay.
You wear them all
the time, do
you?
As soon as I get up in the morning and take them off last thing at night.
Okay.
Very, very focal, so... Mm-hmm. You focus on your focus.
Yeah, so they are for more than one distance. They are for reading and for the far side.
I was hoping it would improve my golf.
Yes?
No.
Not really. Oh, you're not playing with the glasses, but with your arms. That's the problem, maybe.
Yes.
You like playing golf?
Oh, yes. It's a game we never, ever perfect.
Yes. Yes.
Not even the master players, but in fact, they have their off days and get their wild shots occasionally.
Yes. I don't know anything about golf. Except there's a ball and there's a club.
You have to apply it. You've got to take it straight back and you've got to go straight through and straight forward. If you do this sort of any kind of motion like that, then the ball will go all sorts of places.
Yeah, it puts.
And you have to get the blade exactly at the right angle to the ball, not there. And of course, with the blade, you can.
Yeah.
Upright or when
yes.
There's a natural loft, what they call a loft on the club. That's why you've got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and lots of people say, I wish I could have 10.
Oh, okay. Is one the easiest or what is
the one? The one is the straightest. There is a 1 iron and a 2 iron that's not very common in club golf, it might be a professional golf. So most people don't go by the 3 as they and then as you go over the numbers, when you get to 8, it's quite an angle on it.
And what does it mean? It goes further or it goes...
The lower the number, the further it should go. And obviously when the pros measure the distance between where they are and where the flag is, we choose the right colour. But they know they can always hit a 5 iron. X number of yards. I guess a mortal's like myself, well, if I hit it right, it'll go X yards. If I don't hit it right, it'll be X minus whatever.
Okay.
Yeah. But I've just taken up crown green bowls, which is another fascinating thing. But once again, with this round wood, you've got to get your arms straight back and straight through. Tendency to do that at the end. Completely destroy the direction in which it goes. And the wood has a bias in the quantities because of weight on one side. So you could hold it, they talk about finger and thumb.
Okay.
So the thumb has got a slight indentation and the finger it hasn't. So you pick up your bowl and you say to your opponent, I'm using finger. Or thumb, as the case may be. You have to give them that information. And if you use thumb, the ball will go along quite straight and then it will curve to the right.
Okay.
And if it's finger, it goes on quite straight and then curve to the left. Now the thing about crown green bowling, he's got slight rise in the middle of the green. So you've got to get it up the slope, and then hopefully you know what happens when it goes down the other side. And sometimes you get it absolutely wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of ending up near the jack, the small ball,
yeah.
So I've only just started this because I thought, well, I can know I'm going to play golf. But you need the stamina. I mean, if you go around the golf course the full distance, it's 5 miles. Mark Twain used to say it's a good walk spoiled. The American writer, Mark Twain.
Yeah. And what did he say?
It's a good walk spoiled. Playing golf.
Is it good?
A good walk, spoilt.
Spoilt.
Yeah.
But nowadays they have golf carts, don't they? Do you walk?
I do at the moment. I'm playing with somebody who we sometimes have a buggy.
Yeah.
A cart and wheel thing.
But just for the clubs.
Although he's younger than me, he's not in such good condition. So sometimes we have a buggy.
The buggy means that just for the
you can put your clubs on the back of it.
Yes.
And it's just got a motor that's charged up.
So you sit on it too.
You sit on it.
Yes.
Yeah. You kind of stuff and hit your ball, get back on.
Yeah.
Go forwards and legs.
But still, it's about half of running around and picking up the.
Oh yes, it's good exercise.
Yeah. And I think you have a golf course in just about every community, don't you?
Yes, there's one here in Buxton, which is quite far out.
Mm-hmm.
Not far short of 1,000 feet here. 300 metres.
Mm-hmm.
350 metres.
So it's Buxton, I think, is the highest town in the UK?
Yes, it's the highest town of that sort of size. There are villages there.
Yeah. There, we saw one that was saying the highest village. It was near Buxton.
Yes.
And
I think it's called Flash.
But we couldn't find a parking place. It was so narrow. There was no place to park this car.
No.
We would have to stay in the middle of the road and see what happens.
The warning lights.
Yes.
It's quite comfortable, your vehicle, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's great.
Yes.
We're very glad.
You'll have to heat it up.
We can heat it up.
You can heat it up with anything.
We can heat it up. It works with gas. We can turn on the gas and makes it warm within minutes. You know, it's really getting so warm that you have to take your clothes off. It's really comfortable.
Mm.
And we have a shower with warm water and running cold and warm water. When we heat it up, it's warm water.
Mm-hmm.
And usually we just rinse the dishes with cold water. I have special racks that are taking off the grease and keep the grease in the rack, and then you can wash the rack with your normal clothes.
Yes.
And I have several of those, and it does. I do the greasy stuff with the towel, with the paper towel, and then it's actually just a little bit of running cold water.
It's very good at washing up?
Yes. We do all work together. It's if I see that he has work, then I do it and the other way around.
Yes.
So there's no saying about it. It just happens.
It's sharing.
It's sharing. Yeah. It's really...
I think most marriages have to share. And if they don't, they're in trouble.
And the most that do not share, they get in trouble. And they won't be around there for a long while. So, you've been married for a long time?
I've been married twice.
Okay.
My first marriage lasted 31 years, and we divorced in 1992, I think. And 2 years later, I remarried.
Okay.
Chris is my second.
Oh, okay. I've been married twice too.
Yeah. You say love is sweeter the second time around.
Yes, of course. How long? So 94 was the since you married then? You said till
95.
Okay,
so 23 years.
Oh, okay.
And I'm hoping for a second silver wedding.
Sure.
And I'm hoping to spend it in Vienna.
Oh, great! So you have to come and visit us.
we talked about being in Austria, and we had a coach trip to Vienna on a Monday, when all of us, because we love going to art galleries and museums, and shut.
They are all shut.
I complained to the company that did it. He said, well, we can't cater for every taste, you know, yours is a minority interest.
I wonder why a big city like Vienna closes on Mondays, because they could work around with people would stay in the galleries and offer.
So we thought our wedding anniversary would be in August, quite a nice warm time of the year,
yes.
Not too hot, I hope. Mm-hmm. So that's when we should be, hopefully, in August 2020.
2020, oh, yeah. That's a great year. It's a great number.
So I've got to keep healthy till then, at least.
You what?
I will have to keep healthy.
Oh, sure, yes.
As best I can.
Yes, play golf and walk around.
Unfortunately, I haven't had too many troubles.
Which
troubles? Troubles. I've had a medical problem for nearly 2 years, but it's been resolved.
Okay.
It's what old men get, plumbing.
Oh, okay.
Mm. Yeah, and you can't pee or that sort of thing. Mm. But now it's okay.
Okay. It's great. It's necessary to be fed, to be healthy for traveling.
I had to use a catheter for 21 months.
Okay.
And when I said to men what I have to do with a catheter, I couldn't do that.
Mm.
Okay.
And I said, if you have to do it, you can do it.
Yes.
You have no choice.
Yeah. You learn so much in life.
Yeah.
You have to do it.
But it was a great relief when it was over.
Yes.
They did the operation in July, and they stuck a big catheter in it, and it was supposed to come out within a week, and it was 18 days. Eventually, blocked one night, called out a nurse, district nurse. They come out for any time of the day. She unblocked it. Next morning, it's blocked again. So in fact, the next nurse took it out completely. And so I didn't have to go to hospital to have it done there.
Yeah.
It was done at home. What a relief.
Yeah. But now it's all over.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah. Great. So we are not too far from Vienna. Maybe you can visit us if we're around.
Oh, I don't know whether we have transport. We might have. Don't know whether we're hiring a car or not. So. Are you on a bus route or a train route?
We are 3 kilometers from the train. But there's a cab or something that you could go. Or we could pick you up. If we're around, we don't know yet.
Well, I like making European friends. I've had quite a lot of them.
Yeah.
And through my work, really, because I taught American studies.
And American studies?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
That's a long story in itself, really. I had, when I was at college in London, at King's College, we had 2 American professors in successive years. And I thought, well, that's different. Instead of doing same old, aim at it, English literature, let's do some American.
Mm-hmm.
And I got hooked. And eventually started teaching. Well, I went to Ghana for 4 years. When I came back, I got a job in Liverpool. And doing English, and after a while I said to my head of department, could I perhaps do a short course on American literature? Yeah, why not, he said, why not? So that's how it started, and then a little bit later somebody in the geography department said, oh Derek, you'll be interested in that. There's going to be a conference down at the University of Sussex in Brighton. Do American studies. I know you're interested in America. So I signed up for that. And then a little bit later I was able to say to the big chief, the head of the college, can I start an American studies department? And this was during a period of expansion. Well, what's happening now?
Yeah.
And so we set off with 24 students, and when I left we had 500.
Oh. Wow. So you were teaching at the university?
No, it was a college.
A college.
For education. It then became a university institute, and then finally now it's called Hope University. faculty status, so I never got to be a professor.
Okay.
Sadly.
Thank you.
Well, I've written two books, both of which are unpublished.
Were not published?
No.
Mm-hmm.
The second one nearly made it, but I got a couple of poor reviews and then published it.
What was the reason they were not published?
Well, it was a rather encyclopedic book because the second one was on regional America, and I was inspired by a man who wrote The Nine Nations of North America. And he divided California as one separate bit, and different bits, and the south was another bit,
yeah.
And the northeast was another bit, and so on. And so I looked at all the cultural things that were going on in each of these regions.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a bit encyclopedic. I don't suppose it was totally readable. I thought it was good,
yes,
obviously.
Of course.
And, but it did me good in a way because it made me do a lot of research.
Yeah. It was good for you.
Yeah. And I had to do a lot of research to get my PhD.
Mm-hmm.
I started with a bachelor's at King's College London. I was then in Ghana for 4 years.
In Ghana?
Ghana, yeah. And I did an external master's from Ghana. So when I came home. And then I went to America for a year on exchange in Ohio, Springfield, Ohio. It was a Lutheran college.
Mm-hmm. Which one was it? What was the name of the college?
Witten.
Where was it? Where was it?
It was in Springfield. There are lots of Springfields.
Yes.
The most famous one is Springfield, Illinois, because it's connected to Abraham Lincoln. But Springfield, Ohio is pretty famous too.
Okay.
Possibly because of the Lutheran
thing.
The interesting thing about Springfield, I discovered very early on, the main road is called Limestone Avenue. And I was just traveling down it and said, first Lutheran church. A little further down, a few hundred yards. Second Lutheran church. Then on the other side of the road, fourth Lutheran church. So I asked, why this? Oh, well, when people got dissatisfied at number one, they started number two, and so it progressed. So you've got four Lutheran churches all doing something slightly different.
Yeah. And the people that were there, they started the new one, the older ones still remained.
Oh, yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Interesting.
And of course, America's quite a God-fearing country. The church attendance is way up on anywhere in Europe.
They're living.
Apart from maybe the Catholic countries.
Yes.
The Polish Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
Even their attendance is going down. It used to be about 95%.
Yeah.
Now it's sort of 70 or 65.
Yes.
Spain maybe is keeping up its Catholic population more than Poland.
I don't know.
No.
But when I was in America, I also stayed in America for a year, and I was in Oregon, and I was there in a family that was going regularly to church, and it was also...
That's where you're in Oregon?
In Portland.
In Portland.
In the suburb of Portland, in Milwaukee.
We have friends in Corvallis.
Corvallis, yes.
Which is right in sort of the middle of the Central Valley.
Mm-hmm.
Near to Eugene, rather than to Portland.
Yeah. Yeah, I was in Eugene, in Portland, in Corvallis. I was taken there for school meetings.
I met this man when I was doing some research in London,
mm-hmm.
and he helped me writing one of my books. He would criticize it and scribble all over it.
Okay.
So that was good. He died now, unfortunately. He was 10 years older than me. He died a couple of years ago. He was a very good friend, and we visited him several times.
Mm-hmm.
He also got me into drinking gin. I've always hated gin.
Here.
Perfume.
Yes.
The scent, the taste. So he said, it's a really hot day. I think it was 99 degrees Fahrenheit or something like that. Corvallis. He said, I'm a gin type. Oh, I can't drink it. I said, perfume. And he said, well, drink some Tanqueray. 10 minutes, I'm perfect. And I better look back. Not that I think gym.
Okay.
Every day of the week. It has to be hot. You know, this hot spell, I have to do the gym. Then I can do it again. But not now, it's too cold now.
Yeah, no. But this summer you had a lot of opportunities, I think.
Oh, yes, and we're going to have some more warm weather.
Yes,
where's your next port of call? Next place you're going to.
What?
Next place. How are you doing?
Good.
Good.
Yes.
I'm not moving around too much, are
you? Not
expression's changing a bit.
Yeah, it's normal.
It's normal. Usually people are a little bit tense in the beginning, but then when they forget the cameras and everything, yeah, that they are aided, yeah, it's okay.
Yes.
What do you feel
comfortable? Yes, I'm fine.
You've been born here in this area, or are you?
No, I was born in Wales.
In Wales?
A little tiny place called Prestine. If you want to look that up, it's P-R-E-S-T. I'll tell you why, isn't it? Because I'm not embarrassed about my origins. If it's of interest.
Yes.
It's just inside the Welsh border. It's about halfway down. It's in mid Wales, and my mother was a single mum. I was told, when I inquired about my father, oh, you both had pneumonia. You survived and he died.
Mm.
It wasn't until I was 60 years old that I found out the true story. My mother's sister, younger sister, just quite suddenly said, your father had done die. And this was the reason that my mother left Liverpool, where she was working as a nurse, because of the shame. You know, talking about 1933. That time to be born out of Red Hot Girl was not a good thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
You were a bastard. That's mm-hmm. the word they used to use.
Was he married?
Yes, I found out later. Yeah, I had a wife.
Okay.
And I actually have a half brother who's 2 years younger than me, if he's still alive. But whether to look him up or not, I really don't know. It was a shock at my age. Are they on the sex plans? It's not that important to me to actually meet him.
You, it was not so important?
I think it only been for, you know, interest.
Yeah.
It might take more harm than it could, you
know. Mm-hmm. Maybe you didn't even know.
You get these really looking programs on TV at the moment, don't
yeah.
you?
Yeah.
People are reunited after many years apart.
Yeah.
And it's a great happy event, but I think sometimes it could be the opposite.
Mm.
So, yeah. And it's not, I think it's made me. It's made me very independent, being an only child. I wished I had a sister I could foster. It didn't happen. But it's also made me very, how shall I put it, respectful of women, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because I had to keep my mother on board, she was the only one I'd got. And so I've got this tendency that I feel the need to please women rather than mm-hmm. recognize them.
Yeah.
And that's why I get on with females of any age, young or old. And I set up a person coming to Buxton on Bank Holiday Monday. She hits him very close to her. I've seen him a few times, we got talking. And she's probably my sort of age. And she's been high from
me. Mm-hmm.
She's probably got lots of stories to tell, too, if you. And gets to know. I'm interested in looking at stories, as obviously you two are.
Yes.
Mm. So where are we going from here?
You can you can tell me if you were born at home or in the hospital.
It was at what's called a field hospital, not a field hospital, a country hospital.
Yes. Yeah, so it wasn't, your mother was a nurse, you said?
Yes. So, of course, she gets activated employment, didn't she? And she's not around. I did find out about that. There's a website called Ancestry.
Yes.
You pay a certain amount of money and you can track your genealogy as best you can. It turns out that my father died before my mother.
Okay.
My mother died in 1958, I think. Just a short of 1958, 1957. Had a heart attack. Well, she collapsed on Euston Road. She used to work for British Rail in a clerical capacity. And she was walking back to the underground station. And she was picked up, dusted down, and she carried on home, went to the doctors, said, oh, you're run down, you need a tonic. So in the 1950s, people didn't suspect heart attacks, especially when it was raining.
Yes, it was hard, how it
It's changed now, of course, where you're drinking so much. It has, yes,
you're going to say that's the reason?
Yeah. Well, it's a partial.
Yes.
I just said it to be.
Yes. There are more females smoking, more drinking. I think they are adapting all the
well, you want to be equal much, don't you?
Yes, of course. Yes. But our heart attacks, they offer themselves different than from the end. They look like a stomach ache.
Anyway, 6 weeks later, she died. I found her behind it. Well, I couldn't open the door, she'd fallen behind it. But then when I looked at my dad, he died in the air. I don't know what off, he died in Colchester in Essex, long way from anywhere I know. So I haven't been able to see my half brother.
No, your
half brother,
you have not.
I don't think I have.
Yeah.
I have thought about it long and hard. The trouble is, his name is Michael J. Holland. So when you go online, you get the American actor. Pages and pages and pages. So when you can trace Michael J. Pollard's and Michael X. Pollard's, you know. But a lot of it's about Pollard's quite fairly common name.
But he has not the same last name as you.
Yes.
Why?
Oh, fine. Why should we change his name?
No, the same as yours. He has another last name as yours.
Yes.
Yes, of course. Yeah. Because you were named after your mother's, I suppose.
Yes.
That's the rule in UK.
He was named after the man who made her pregnant.
Yeah.
But that is... I don't know what went wrong and why they didn't get married. But I don't have a nice certificate, any of that certificate.
You don't have
a birth certificate. I don't have a marriage certificate.
Yes.
I just have a birth certificate. And he's down as Alan Curler. And I know where he was born in Lancashire. I know that a lot of my rest of my family come from the Manchester area. Where I was told my father was born in Truro. Long way from Manchester.
Yeah.
And finally, the first time I went to Truro, with this in my back of my mind, I felt almost at home there, as if perhaps I had been born in Truro after all. But no, the evidence is not there.
Mm-hmm. Well, so you started your life with a lot of lies, or it was the big lie in your life.
Yes. Yeah.
You were 13 or 16 when you found out? How old were you when you...
16.
16.
16? 60.
Oh. 16. Oh, you only found out when you were 16.
Mm. Oh.
I understood the first time 16.
I'm sorry. No, 16.
At the age of 16 you found out.
Well, my aunt was in ill health. In fact, she died probably within the year of telling me. So she perhaps she thought, honey, it'd be better than that now. He won't go chasing his father because, well, she didn't know her father was dead, but that was the fear that, you know, try and find him.
Yeah.
Be rather angry about it.
So you had the choice at that time to find
him. And I also, my father had a sister, and know that she went to Canada and ended up in Victoria. That's Vancouver Island, opposite.
Yeah.
There is a possibility I could have gone on the train and asked to see if she was still alive, but we didn't do that.
What difference does it make?
That's right, you get to a point where...
Yes, you say your whole life you have been brought up with this and...
I've survived all this.
Yeah.
I'm happy to find myself.
Yeah.
I don't have any photos or...
Yeah. So if this was the truth for you, it was the truth, and that
yes.
was...
No, it isn't the truth.
And that felt okay.
Yeah, I felt okay about it. I'm perhaps glad I didn't have burnout.
Yes, yes. Because very often at the age of puberty, between 13 and 16, when they find out that their parents have lied at them,
yes.
then they
but
get
their mothers and their birth.
Really difficulties. So nowadays we say it's better to tell the truth from the beginning. Because then the kids take it as normal,
yes.
and they can cope with it much better than they find out at an age where they have trouble with themselves, trying to know who they are and what they do and so on.
Yeah.
When then there's this finding out and wanting to know who is my real dad
yes.
and who
yes.
is my the person.
Yes, my wife's sister, younger sister, Mary. She ended up pretty much the same way. Not sure whether she was married, and they split up. And as they were going to Canada together, her husband said, when we get there, I don't really have anything more to do with you. When she got to Mississauga, which is near Toronto, she fell in love with another man, and she became pregnant. And then, I don't know whether or not the candidate to ask her, came back to her with a child. And that child, Karen, and the child, went to find her father. In fact, was a Swedish American living in Vancouver.
Mm-hmm.
He had her mother daughter, about 8 years older than Karen, and she hoped that she could make a relationship with her long lost dad. But it didn't happen.
He refused.
Well, he became an alcoholic, actually. He's dead now. She's been over recently with her mother to meet her half sister, and it wasn't a successful trip.
So it's very hard, very sad, and
yes, because she knew it was a father. She's hoping for something better.
Yes, yes. And you always can put all the imagination into a person that is not there, rather than to a father that's
yes.
right
yes.
next to you there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, I don't think I've even inherited either gene from my father, because I am lost, I think. 7 years younger.
Yeah.
I was playing golf. The golf course is quite close by,
it's a bit further south down the Devon Valley, and you start off hole one, hole two, and then hole three, hole four, hole five, hole six, hole seven. And watch, I couldn't get my breath. I mean, normally, you get out of breath in within a minute, two, or three minutes, you've got your breath back. Well, I wasn't getting my breath back. I wasn't in pain, exactly. Mm. But it was a kind of tightness across the breath. Not when you expect it, really.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I can't go on. So the next hole is called Desolation. Oh, you've got names.
Yes.
I'm not doing the one. So there were four of us playing, so the kind of captain of the four said, oh, well, I will keep out to the clubhouse. Okay, I got changed. So I had a cup of tea and a chocolate biscuit or something. And then I got up.
Mm-hmm.
So I sat down again, and the waitress came across to me. I said, well, maybe, should I call a paramedic? I said, not a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Within 10 minutes, there was a paramedic who was always here, and before one, before opening, taking an extra cardiac
round.
So I think better get you to the hospital.
Did you get a scan?
What?
Did you get a stent?
Two.
Yeah.
I have two.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's a candidate for that also.
Yeah.
So you were lucky.
I was lucky. I was lucky that time. It was treated
in time.
I didn't actually have a stent put in until I'd been in the hospital about 3 days. It was that weekend. And I actually walked down to the chapel to go to the hospital. Ah, you can't look around. Because they knew what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
But I had a room all to myself, you know, so it was quite nice. Reading materials informed me of something.
Mm-hmm.
My younger daughter and her husband arrived the very next day. They came across and looked at me to see how it was. So both my spells in hospital were in. The other one's still in the plumbers.
So you have two daughters?
Yes.
Two daughters and son? No, no son. It's just two daughters.
That was a big tragedy. I'd actually had a year in America. And we'd been married 10 years. My first wife wasn't very keen on physical relationships. And all I explained to her, I don't know what that's about. And got her pregnant. We came home, and in December the child was born. It was a Down syndrome baby, and he lasted a couple of hours.
Mm.
So after 10 years, I had that happen. That was a big event, really. Big tragedy.
Mm.
So we went for genetic counselling. Lovely man called Mr. All the Walkers, people called Walker in my life, have all been good guys. One, I actually shared a room at college with a Walker. My garage I used to go to, there was a large mechanic called Walker. And now there was this consultant called Walker. He said, well, given your age, Josephine, I would think you've probably got a 1 in 250 chance of having another Down syndrome baby. And he could see our jaws drop. He said, hang on a minute, that means 249 chances of having a perfectly normal baby. Oh. So we got out of that shop and fortunately we tried again. Without any force this time. And then we had first a daughter, another miscarriage, and a second daughter.
Mm-hmm.
So sadly, no son, but I do have a grandson.
Oh, okay.
He's five. He's called Theo.
Theo.
Because my wife sometimes calls me Theo, because Derek,
you probably know this, comes from Theodoric.
Theodoric.
Or Theodore, Theodoric.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So, and my, he's called Theo Thomas McLaughlin. My grandfather was called Thomas Thackeray Deakin. So, Tom's or Theo's or something, they look at the front line. So, I don't know.
Who's Tom?
He's a strange man. He's perfectly nice and normal and gets on well with our children. But he has meltdowns. The last time I saw him, when I was over in Merseyside area, we virtually coincided, the cars virtually came together. He was so excited, you know, the cars, I was like, granddad, granddad. And he was holding a balloon. And in his excitement, he let the balloon go. He was up 75 feet in the air, and he howled, it took 2 hours before it returned to normality.
Mm. Yeah, but that's...
Okay, it's something you grow out of. Mm. Anger management.
But now you can get it on your blue.
That's a good idea, isn't it?
I thought balloons were a fun thing. When I was a kid, like this age, just must be a magical age of 5. I still remember that we had I don't know who it was, but there was a lot of balloons being raised purposely, and my dad would bring one down from a really high tree, and he was bringing it down for us, and it was so important that he did that for us, and even it was raised in the top of the on the ceiling, you know, we could take it down, and even when it was getting smaller and smaller, my dad would still take it in pieces and blow little balloons out of just the material. See, now this is a long time ago, and I still remember it. So these things, till today, are important for kids. Like the little fellow that's sitting over there, mm-hmm. Freddy, he's watching all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, he's watching Wilfred also.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you think perhaps for the next 10 minutes or so I can take a drink?
Sure. I can get you one.
Yeah.
What
I wouldn't mind a cup of tea especially a glass of water.
Yes.
I'm getting dry.
Okay. So milk or sugar or something for the tea?
Tea, just milk. No sugar. Milk.
Okay. And sugar. A glass of water.
Sugar is level.
Okay.
Do you always do portraits?
I'm hopeless at portraits. People learn how to. I think I said to you that they don't like lunatics, it's staring eyes. Mm-hmm. You know. My mother-in-law is excellent at portraits, really good. And she gave me a lot of encouragement when I started, 17 years ago. She died 4 years ago.
Oh.
She had an aortic aneurysm, so it's really bizarre. Mm-hmm. Good way to go for her, but not for us. We just had her moved. She lived in Derby, all her life, and she moved out to be closer to us. She was just 2 miles down the road, and 5.5 weeks later, she was dead.
Mm.
We're not in the same moving house every day, which is not a good idea. We tried to persuade them to do it earlier. But, and certain stubbornness, I suppose. Not quite knowing what would happen if she did. I think there's probably an old age, isn't there? You do get set in your ways, and I try to avoid that if I can. I quite like doing new things.
Mm.
I was just listening to Andreas Schiff, the pianist, concert pianist, who was playing Bach, I think, last night.
Mm-hmm.
He was born in Hungary,
mm-hmm.
next door to you, and when things started getting very right-wing in that country, I've been to Hungary, nearly 20 years ago now. Quite a lot has changed. He then went to Austria, and then he didn't stay there very long, but he was seeing right-wing tendencies in Austria as well. And now he's become to Britain. He's got nationalised Britain, British.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think that's very sad, isn't it, when you're sort of forced out of your the country of your birth. I don't know why we don't have more compassion for all these refugees.
Mm.
They just put up their barriers all the time.
Yeah.
I've been a dedicated Europeanist since about the age of 19.
Mm.
And that all happened to me when I was chosen as the school representative for what was then an empire conference before it called the Commonwealth. And we met in a big place in Trafalgar Square. And I met people from the Tonga, Canada, Gold Coast, I think it was, South Africa, India. People all of my age, 17, 18. And we got on with each other.
Yeah.
So you can do it that sort of age. You don't have any preconceptions, right? I was just asking Wilfred whether he'd been in other places apart from Austria.
Oh, yes.
He's been well travelled.
Yes.
I was saying how sad it is when you know you're forced to leave your country of your birth and get moved on to pianist called Andreas Schiff. He was playing Bach's second book, the Tempered Clavier, last night where I'm from. He's Hungarian, and he didn't like what Orban is doing, so he's moved to Austria, and he doesn't like the right-wing guy you've got, his name I can't remember.
Kurz.
So he's not come to Britain.
Yeah.
So I hope we don't.
What's going to happen here now?
I was saying to Wilfred that I'm a dedicated Europeanist because I went to a conference in London when I was 17, 18, chosen at the school, represented the school.
Okay.
And there were people there from all over the empire, as it then was.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever the map was wearing, and people would come, and there were Canadians, and Tongans, and Fijians, and people with the Gold Coast, and everywhere.
Yeah.
And we got on so well. More recently, I tutored a woman from Myanmar, or Burma, I had to do an MA in the situation. And we've been corresponding ever since, by email now.
Mm-hmm.
Letters are all that we want. We feared censorship all the time. But emails are always okay.
Yeah.
I died too, went to India for my 65th birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And
how long?
Fifteen days.
Mm-hmm.
3/5 which were in Nepal. But I got the Delhi belly. And it was the day they were going to go to the mountain range. But I didn't see eyes.
From
the air.
From the air.
The pilots there. That was looked down.
Mm-hmm.
Actually flying over.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
But I got
was it a clear day?
Yes, it was. Leaving the pool, I got all worst threat ever. There were some Americans who came on board, and they looked a bit like Donald Duck. They had to put things over their nose and mouth, you know. I found out more later. I've got this terrible throat. And I was examined at the camera on the throat and all sorts.
Started to talk about the European Union, I suppose? Or just about traveling?
I think it's been the craziest thing that's happened in my lifetime.
So we, you mean?
Yeah. I can see how it happened.
Yes.
The worst thing about it was a total lack of information about why we should leave and why we should stay.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've got a few politicians that try to make my name.
Yes,
so.
I don't know if it was a lack of information. I think it was too much information about the wrong place. Manipulated opinions, which were not the reason that you should go or leave or remain. I think it was more manipulated opinions that were for the mass people, which were not able to.
And how you allow Nicholas Farage into the European Parliament, and the federal thing seems to stand up and say, I would have had it maxed out. I think Congress or Parliament were directing their duties. If somebody gets up in the Houses of Parliament and starts saying things like that, they're suspended. The Speaker of the House says, leave the chamber.
Yeah.
And you won't go, here's it.
Yeah.
It's sorted out. Somebody on each side.
Yeah.
Oh, he's a wicked fellow, that man. Wait, he's just an egoist, isn't he? It's a bit like Trump. He wants to get his name in the front of the headlines every day.
Yes, that's good. That's good.
That sounds good.
Caroline made it
for
you. What? Caroline made it for you.
Because we are not tea drinkers. We are coffee drinkers.
Yes, well, I drink coffee as well. First thing in the morning.
And when we hear English people having a cup of tea, it's always black tea, but we have herb tea, we have fruit tea, and black tea is not as popular as it was when I was young. Now it is more the different, many, many different kinds of mixtures.
Rooibos.
Rooibos and all kinds of tea.
My stepdaughter.
Peppermint or, I don't know, all kinds of herbs you can mix in.
Lapsang souchong? Lapsang souchong?
I don't know that.
Don't know that.
No.
So what a letter from there. L-A-P-S-O-G. Souchong. S-O-U-C-H-O-N-G. It comes from there. China, Japan, that area.
Okay.
Used to be.
So how do you think what would the
that must be also
the leaving of the European Union mean to your life, or what do you think, what changes will occur with the...
Well, I'm still hoping it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
I think there might be some last-minute adjustments on both sides, and I think it might get a deal. Because you don't want us to leave.
No.
That's fair.
Yeah, I think...
That's why you're making it as difficult as possible.
Yeah.
But I think at the end, if May keeps on saying, I'm good at it, but there's no risk. I think your side, the area of the inside, will stretch. Why have you got this problem with the Irish border?
Yeah.
Are the Irish in Ireland going to smuggle stuff into Northern Ireland or vice versa?
Yes.
Of course not.
I don't know. If it happens, if one starts it, maybe, and they have a profit out of it, why not? You know, there's always...
Money.
Yes, it's always the money that's in mind. So... I don't think all the border stuff is so stupid. I mean, we're all human beings. Why do we put borders? Why do we put walls? What's the good for it? If there are no borders, there are no problems.
And then there's phrase the United States of Europe.
Yeah.
Why does that sink in people's throats?
Yes, it's not. Doesn't matter.
You've always been European.
Yeah.
Well, you joined to you by land at one time.
But there were so many wars and so much going on that didn't really help. And there was the First World War and the Second World War, which at the end only had losers and no real winners.
Mm-hmm.
If you cut it down, you know. The real winners arose when they had to build everything up and do all the buildings and all the economy and all the infrastructure to make it better than it was before.
Yeah.
So they were the real winners. The economy was the winners.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be that like that all the time. You don't have to destroy something in order to build it up. But it seems like in order to see the history, there always has to be something had to be destroyed so that something else could be built up. And I think that's what history was.
Chinese history.
Yeah.
We've had 10 dynasties. It's all being on that pattern.
Yeah.
Destroy the one, start again.
Yeah. Yes. So with economy, it's not necessary because it's all working by itself, by doing things, putting demands into people that they didn't have before. And that's what's making business run. Because as long as you didn't know there was a phone that you could carry around, you were not wanting one, you know? And only when it was there, you could grieve for it, you could want it, and now you could want a better one, and so on. So you don't have to put war in the world in order to make business go, because there's always the development, there's always thinking, there's always things that the one has and the other one wants to have. So it's not necessary to have war, to have weapons, but obviously those who have the weapons have the might and the say. And as long as there are weapons around, I think that's how the world goes on, because you have to get rid of the weapons, you have to give them to people, then they have to hit each other. So then you can start a new business.
Well, you're saying jaw is better than war.
Jaw, that means?
Talk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what a common saying.
So what if it happens, and if the United Kingdom will not be part of the European Union, how do you think it will affect your life? What will be the first thing that occurs to you that will happen?
I think the cost of living will go up.
The living costs.
Every
day, living costs to everybody.
And there will be a
large group of Brits who don't need a camera now, who's already near the borderline.
Yeah.
And then what do we do?
The magic word is work. Whoever cannot work and has an income, it has a problem. But that is not something that is just in the UK, with or without being part of the European Union. It's just not enough work around.
So, when you get people in the European Parliament, like for a Russian, I don't think he's a young person, I don't follow the we don't really have access to, we're not televising what happens in Strasbourg and Brussels.
Yeah, sure.
So we don't know exactly who's getting out and saying what they're saying. But if there's things going wrong, why isn't there an attempt to examine that and say, well, what's going wrong? What can we do about it?
Yes.
Now, the English made the great mistake, the British made the great mistake. Instead of Farage shouting off about how dreadful things are, you know, why didn't he say, well, let's try and put things right?
Yes.
Because he wasn't that sort of person.
No.
He shouldn't have been there. That sort of person should have been there.
Yeah.
There should be more people from other countries who are saying, well, it isn't quite working for us.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not bad, but it could be better.
Could we do change this and that? And maybe you have a situation that's good for you as well.
Yes.
Instead of going the wrong track together. Mm. Let's just talk about it. Yeah, we're perfectly happy.
Four people, 13 pounds each, random, four seats. The idea is to make so many tricks. You need to win 7 out of the 13, and that you go 1 and 8 is 2, 9 is 3, etc. All of the lot is a grand slam. You can go in all 13 rounds. It doesn't happen very often. These two, she was a very good player. They were called Buffington. And he was playing to get all the tricks. And I was watching it. And the first half done the trick. Then he got to about 10. And you could see his furrows. And he got to 12, which was called the Little Slam.
Mm-hmm.
He played the last card, and you could almost see it. And he played it. A sense of relief. And then Mrs. Buffington said, honey, if you play that right, you'd have gone one down. If I'd been Mr. Buffington, I should have thought that's horrible. What a thing to do. No, most people don't like accents because they're how you describe certain journals and they're very brash and loud.
They don't like to be put them on board.
Mm-hmm. And I've been to quite a few conferences in Germany. My favourite friends in Hamburg,
mm-hmm.
or Altonat, which is the
Altonat.
Altonat. Example of German humour. We were all in a rat house, and this group was. The buzzword was situation. This is an interesting situation, or etc. Anyway, this guy put his beer glass down. So, I have an empty beer glass situation. Yeah, you've got a sense of humour.
Yes.
It was rectified very quickly, of course.
Yeah. Right. I'm happy you can, because I thought it was only my
problem. A lot of people speak too fast. They also interrupt each other.
Yes.
In a, what's called an interview, when the interviewer says more than the interviewee. Come on,
yes.
What's this about? You're just putting your opinion. I wanted to hear what he had to say.
Yes, very rude. It's we had a TV interview with many people around the table, you know, and it was really hard to follow because after some time, when they were really good, one would start to cut the word with another one, and then it would be just like an avalanche. And you wouldn't understand anything. And that's not good for the people who watch the interview, because you don't get anything, just quarreling. And that's it.
It may be because they're trying to time everything.
Yes.
Between 8:10 and 9:00, there are so many minutes. We can allocate so many minutes for this person, for that person, and so on. So we've got to get allocated at the end.
And the moderator sometimes has a hard job to...
Yes, to part the number.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I think if you go to a Quaker session, you learn a lot. Because there, they call it ministry. And you've got something to say, and it's not a prepared thing. It's something that comes to you while you've been in a period of silence. You get to your feet and you say out loud what you've got to say and sit down.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody jumps up to their feet. Minutes can go by. 3, 5, 10. Then someone else will get up and say, well, following what so-and-so said, my opinion is that perhaps it isn't that way, it's this way. And then they sit down.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps during the hour, you might get 4, 5, maybe 6 ministers. Because you're supposed to think about what's being said.
Yeah.
Why is that? Do you agree with it, or do you have more time? You can't obviously do that on the radio, because you can't have you know, 5 minutes silence between people speaking. But it's a useful exercise.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever been to a Quaker meeting?
No.
Do you fancy going? Do you fancy going? Do you think you'd like to?
Yes, it would be great. It would be a great opportunity to be part of it. We have a session with some people that are communicating in groups. They call it a Redestab. That means the person who talks gets a stick or something in the hand.
Do we do it with stones?
The stones.
There's a stone.
Yeah.
A stone is marshal. Yeah.
And whoever has the stone may talk. Yeah. And all the others have to be quiet and listen.
Yes.
And that's a hard...
I wonder why you're talking about that.
Yeah. I was showing you just
the stick.
It's the stick, yeah. So it's a good exercise.
Yes.
And we have therapy for people who are in a situation where they are in a marriage or in any kind of situation that they have problems with each other.
Mm-hmm.
That one person says something, and the other one has to repeat it. I have heard you have said this and that.
Mm-hmm.
So you do not come up with the argue against. But you have to think, what did the person say?
Yeah.
And you cannot argue, because the whole sitting, the whole hour, you only have to repeat what the other person has said. And by the end, you find out something about the person you have known before. Obviously something that has cooperation between you and the other person. So it's very useful.
When my first marriage was on the rocks, because I had cancer.
Yes.
And it was, you know, my wife there, husband there, somebody in the middle. And we were going to say, what should we say? And then this person.
person who would actually direct the conversation off one topic from some other aspect of
yes.
the situation. Didn't work in our case, but
it was a try.
I've got two stories about plumbing. That's to do with getting in a legal exit at 239. Can you believe that? That number?
Yes.
Of course, you've been to America, but to tell a Briton on the way. 239 was closed.
Oh.
Oh.
So what?
I'd come out of 240. Oh. Completely rebuilt myself.
Oh, shit.
I did. But, and then down the main highway to Providence. Coming back, I'll take a country route. I won't go on the state highway. And I thought I'd left ourselves enough time to catch the plane. And we came out. We had lunch, we had a coffee somewhere, and then we still got an hour, a couple of hours to get to Portland. How did we get across the river? Oh, is there a bridge? Eventually found one, and we turned up at the airport with about 45 minutes to go. So, those living memories stick in my mind.
Yeah. So you were in a art group yourself?
Yes. Also done a drawing of a dolman down in Cornwall.
Mm-hmm.
And that's come out quite nicely, tucking back.
Do you have a camera or something? Something to show? Yeah.
No, it's not on the camera. This is my sternest critic. Everything I do, yeah. And she's right more often than she's wrong.
I'm built it on.
I told them they got to go in Vienna.
Yeah.
In August 2020.
Wow, got to eat less and save up more. I feel like I'm asked again. Oh, yeah, the eyes are lovely. What? Are you pleased?
Yeah.
Yes.
Definitely, but
yeah, I like it.
What I see, what I can see. You
know? Yeah.
I can see and what I can feel when I listen to what you're talking.
Yeah.
I didn't do all the talking, by the way.
Good.
That's better. I managed to get a few words in there.
You'd be tired.
Well, I had to have a drink, you know, kind of. Yeah. My throat was still dry.
I like the angle of the head on the shoulder as well.
Yeah.
Where he's looking. You can tell he's looking in, probably at that point, listening. But, yeah.
We had a very interesting conversation.
I think it was a deep.
We both sat down, perhaps.
Yeah.
I
love the considering limitations of paper.
Christmas and Navy.
Lovely, isn't it?
So it's
got a lot
to
happen.
Such a different view from up here to see the mountains.
Yeah.
It looks great.
It's the beginning of the morning. It looks like a cross up there.
There's a cross.
There's a cross.
Yes, there's a cross. Yes. And when you have been down to the
There are great portraits there.
So how many people are you in your art?
That's in one group. I'm also in another group in Worcester.
Okay.
There's another lady in another group, and that group only got six or seven.
Okay.
And then just started those in one group. Right.
silver spear.
Yes, I think I like it. I have to get used to it.
Yes, yes. It's not a photo.
No. I think you've captured a bit of my geniality. We've been talking quite a lot about that.
What about you being genial?
No, about the, you know, being human and respectful of other humans, that kind of thing. You know. We did have a good old go at the Germans at one point, but then I said, well, you know, you can't tar people with the same brush. I still think it's a wonderful thing that Schumann and Adam and I got together and started the whole thing off in Europe. I mean, fought each other so many times in recent history.
I think it brings out that kindness in you. You don't look like a sour old man.
Not at all.
No. I think it's a very warm portrait of you. I like it.
I was just wondering about that area there, and there that's at my eye was, that's the angle that I was at.
But,
it's a very minor equivalent.
Yeah, I thought
mine
were really good.
Yeah.
That's more a shadow.
Yes.
I don't think it's the eye socket.
The eyes It was great to listen to you and watching you. I like it very much.
Well, I hope we meet again.
Yeah?
In Austria.
Yeah, sure.
You could be somewhere else.
Yeah, sure.
Yes. You can follow us on the route. Yeah.